Hello, and welcome to this presentation, Understanding ILS. In this short presentation, we'll explain what ILS is and how ILS is used in aviation, as well as provide a technical introduction to the different signals found in ILS. In order to understand ILS, it might be helpful to start with a brief description of how to land a plane. There are three main steps involved in landing an airplane. First, we need to approach the airport and eventually line up the airplane with the center line of the runway. Next, we need to descend towards the runway at an angle that's neither too steep nor too shallow. The latter is important in avoiding any nearby obstructions such as trees. And finally, we need to reduce airspeed, and thus altitude, at the appropriate distances from the runway. Although all of this can be done using purely visual information, in many cases it's also accomplished, either in whole or in part, using instruments. ILS is a system that provides this instrument-based information. ILS, the Instrument Landing System, consists of multiple components. This includes things like approach lighting, runway markings, etc. But in this presentation, we'll only be concerned with the radio frequency signals that are used in ILS. These signals can be divided into three groups. The localizer signal, which provides horizontal or so-called left-right guidance. The glideslope signal, which provides vertical or up-down guidance. And marker beacons, which provide information regarding the distance to the runway. Marker beacons can be outer, middle, or inner markers. Let's start by taking a brief look at these signals and how they're related to the runway. The localizer antenna is located at the end of the runway and transmits a signal that provides left-right guidance. The glideslope antenna is off to one side on the near or landing end of the runway, and its signal provides up-down guidance. The outer, middle, and inner markers are located along the landing path, with the inner marker being closest to the runway and the outer marker being furthest away. In the remainder of this presentation, we'll provide both practical and technical descriptions of these three types of signals. Let's begin our technical discussion of ILS by discussing the frequencies used in ILS. Localizer and glideslope frequencies are paired, with 40 possible pairs of frequencies. As we'll see, the localizer signal is acquired further away from the runway than the glideslope signal, so localizer signals are in the VHF range, and glideslope signals are in the UHF range. More specifically, localizer frequencies are 108.1 to 111.95 MHz, whereas glideslope frequencies are 330.95 to 334.7 MHz. Note that aeronautical charts and airport information only provide the VHF localizer frequency, since navigation receivers will automatically tune to the paired glideslope frequency whenever the localizer is tuned. On the other hand, there's no real need to tune marker beacons, since these all operate on the same frequency, namely 75 MHz. Recall that the localizer signal represents the center line of the runway and provides horizontal guidance. In other words, how far to the left or right of the runway center line we are. The localizer conveys this information by simultaneously transmitting two different lobes, one at 90 Hz, the other at 150 Hz. These patterns are generated by the localizer antenna array located at the far end of the runway. In the aircraft, the localizer compares these two signals and uses the difference to compute the deviation from the center line of the runway. Let's look at a diagram. Here, the localizer antenna array located at the far end of the runway produces a pattern consisting of two lobes. The one on the left side of the runway is modulated at 90 Hz, and the one on the right side is modulated at 150 Hz. These lobes will have approximately equal amplitude along the center line of the runway, allowing the pilot to use the localizer for horizontal guidance during approach and landing. In some cases, two localizer signals are transmitted by the array. These are referred to as course and clearance. The use of dual localizer signals can be used to improve both coverage and precision for certain categories of approaches. These two localizer signals are sent a small distance, typically about 8 kHz, above and below the nominal localizer frequency. For example, if the nominal localizer frequency is 109.5 MHz, the course localizer signal would be 109.508 MHz, and the clearance localizer signal would be 109.492 MHz. These are close enough in frequency that either signal can be received by tuning to the nominal localizer frequency. During the approach, the stronger of these two signals is captured and used by the ILS receiver. In the cockpit, localizer information is often displayed in the form of a needle. If our aircraft is on the center line of the runway, the localizer needle will be centered. If we are to the left of the center line, our needle will look like this, indicating that we need to fly right. And if we're too far to the right, our indicator moves to the left, giving us a fly left indication. Localizer frequency information is also displayed on the approach plates used by pilots. The shaded side of the localizer represents the 150 Hz side, which is always on the right, and the unshaded side is the 90 Hz side. Now let's look at glide slope. Whereas the localizer signal provided horizontal or left-right guidance, the glide slope signal provides vertical or up-down guidance to either the touchdown point or the missed approach point. The glide slope signal is also useful in helping to avoid obstructions, such as trees or other tall objects near the runway. Generally speaking, the angle of the glide slope is 3 degrees down from horizontal, although this may vary somewhat. Similar to what we just saw with the localizer signal, the glide slope signal consists of a 90 Hz and 150 Hz lobe. But unlike the localizer, the glide slope signal is transmitted from an antenna located on the side of the runway, using UHF frequencies instead of the VHF frequencies used for the localizer. Using UHF provides better signal resolution but shorter range compared to the VHF frequencies used by the localizer. The glide slope antenna is typically located about 1,000 feet from the start of the runway. With a 3-degree glide slope, this means that the aircraft will be at an altitude of about 50 feet when it crosses the runway threshold. Like the localizer, the glide slope is defined as a path where the 90 Hz and 150 Hz lobes are received at equal strength. Note that the 90 Hz lobe is strongest above the glide slope, whereas the 150 Hz lobe is strongest below the glide slope. As with the localizer, deviation from the glide slope is shown by needle deflection. For example, if the aircraft is above the glide slope, the needle points downwards and the pilot needs to fly down to intercept the glide slope. An aircraft centered on the glide slope produces a flat, horizontal needle. And if we're below the glide slope, the needle deflects upwards, indicating that the pilot needs to fly up. Glide slope information can also be found on approach plates. Typically, one goal on an instrument approach is to intercept the glide slope. The gray feather on the approach plate shows roughly where the glide slope signal should be reliable. In this approach, the glide slope angle is the standard 3 degrees. The glide slope is intercepted at an altitude of about 2,400 feet at a distance of 6.1 nautical miles from the runway threshold, and the threshold crossing height is slightly higher than normal at 55 feet. Marker beacons provide information on the distance to the runway threshold. All marker beacons transmit on the same frequency of 75 MHz, so the audio frequency and pattern of audio tones transmitted by the beacon are used to distinguish between the different beacon types. There are 3 different types of beacons: outer, middle, and inner. As we'll see in a moment, these names refer to their relative distances from the runway threshold. Marker beacons transmit in a vertical, elliptical pattern, which means their signals are only received or heard when the aircraft is passing almost directly over them. As mentioned a moment ago, there are 3 types of marker beacons, all of which lie along the runway center line. These are the inner marker, middle marker, and outer marker. As the names imply, the inner marker is the closest to the runway threshold, the middle marker is the next closest, and the outer marker is the furthest away. There are no firm definitions on exactly how far each of these markers should be from each other, or from the runway threshold. Usually the outer marker is 4 to 7 nautical miles from the threshold, the middle marker is about 0.5 nautical mile from the threshold, and the inner marker can be anywhere from 200 to 1500 feet from the threshold. Again, these are rough numbers and actual distances vary between airports and runways. It's important to note that not all approaches use all 3 of these markers. In fact, it's relatively rare to find an approach that uses all 3 markers, and in some cases, there are even approaches that use no markers. That said, let's look at an approach plate that shows all 3 markers. Here we see the inner, middle, and outer marker shown. The distances from the runway threshold for each of these markers is also indicated. Note that the abbreviation LOM stands for Locator Marker Beacon, which is a combination of an outer marker and a non-directional beacon, or NDB. Let's take a closer look at the three marker types, starting with the outer marker. As mentioned a moment ago, the outer marker is located from 4 to 7 nautical miles from the runway threshold, and the glide slope is usually intercepted near the outer marker. When flying over the outer marker, a stream of low-frequency dashes will be heard. Blue is used to represent the outer marker, and the blue light on the marker receiver in the aircraft flashes in time with the dashes. The middle marker is usually about a half nautical mile from the runway threshold. In most approaches, the glide slope is about 200 feet above the end of the runway at the middle marker. This is the standard decision height for ILS approaches. This means that the middle marker represents the point at which the pilot has to decide whether he can safely land or whether he should execute a so-called missed approach, go around, and try again. The audio generated by the middle marker is a series of alternating dots and dashes at a higher frequency than the outer marker. Visually, a flashing amber or yellow light indicates the middle marker has been reached. The inner marker beacon is located near the runway threshold, although near is a somewhat broadly defined term, being anywhere from a few hundred to over 1,000 feet. The inner marker is used only for certain categories of ILS approaches, so it's less common than the middle or outer markers. The sound produced by the inner marker is a rapid series of dots at a very high rate and high audio frequency. A white light flashes in time with the dots on the marker receiver. Note that in some cases, the letter A, for airway, is used instead of I on marker receivers. So in summary, ILS, or the Instrument Landing System, is designed for use in approach and landing. The three most important components of the ILS are the localizer, which provides horizontal or left-right guidance, the glide slope, which provides vertical or up-down guidance, and marker beacons, which provide simple visual and audio indications of the distance to the runway. The three types of marker beacons are inner markers, middle markers, and outer markers, although most approaches don't make use of all three marker types. This concludes our presentation, Understanding ILS. Thanks for watching.